Hello, my name is Paul Friedman. I'm chair of the Department of Cardiovascular Medicine. And today I have the good fortune of being joined by my colleague, Dr. Malakh Shrestha, who is the director of the Mayo Clinic Aorta Center of Excellence, director of aortic surgery for cardiovascular surgery. Dr. Shrestha, thank you so much for joining me today.
Thank you very much, Paul. It's a pleasure being together with you today.
Dr. Shrestha, thank you again for joining us today. We're going to talk about the frozen elephant trunk procedure, which has been an important advance in surgical management of aortic dissections, aortic aneurysms. But before we get there, let's review a little bit for our listeners. What are the most common manifestations of, or how are these diseases most commonly diagnosed?
So although aorta is one organ, so there can be various other diseases, for example, an aneurysm or a dissection. In the dissection, it's easy because the patients will have severe pain. What the people that have had it say that the most penetrating pain that one can have in life. So they will have some sort of someone like stabbing pain in the chest. So they would immediately go to the doctor anyway. And then the easiest way, the quickest way would be do a CT scan with contrast to see if there's a dissection in the ascending and the arch of the aorta. So that's easy. There, it's always the CT scan, the best thing. But also, we also need an echocardiography to see whether the aortic valve is involved, if there are other valves involved. So that's the second test that we would need to do. In case of aortic aneurysm, again, to see the dimension of the aorta, CT scan is the best with contrast dye. But also we could do, especially in younger patients, with Marfan patients, we are doing the follow-ups, then an MRI could also play a role there.
Yeah, and so the key is to suspect it from the symptoms and rapidly go to imaging to enable the life-saving surgical intervention. Which brings us to our next question. I'd like to talk to you first about the frozen elephant trunk procedure. What exactly is that procedure and who would benefit from it?
So the frozen elephant trunk procedure is a technique that was developed about 23 years ago to treat complex aortic arch pathologies, both chronic dissections, acute dissections, and also aneurysms, whereby one had its prosthesis that you can replace the whole of the arch and put a stent in the descending aorta so that the patients, at least some of them, can be treated with one-stage procedure. And in some of the patients, even if they do need a second-stage procedure, the second stage could potentially, in many of these patients, be endovascularly treated.
Tell me about the invention and creation of this procedure.
So the classical elephant trunk procedure was also developed in Hanover, where I spent the last 26 years before coming to Mayo Clinic. And Professor Hans Boss in 1982 came up with this so-called elephant trunk technique, which was a revolution for that time. Then around the turn of the century, with new technologies with the stents, we developed this frozen elephant trunk technique. And specifically in 2000, between 8 and 10, I, along with one other surgeon, actually developed the thoraflex graft together with Terum Aortic, which has finally now, after 25,000 implants all over the world, been approved by the FDA to be used in US as of last year.
I see. Well, congratulations on finally getting that approved in the US. It seems like it will open up options. What are the advantages of this approach compared to the other approaches? And maybe before we talk about advantages, you mentioned it was for aneurysms and dissections. Mm-hmm. Any other indications that we should also be aware of?
So it's mostly for the aneurysms and the acute dissections and also the chronic ones. But in the aneurysms, as long as there's a landing zone, then that means in the descending aorta, with this graft, one could treat the patients with a single stage procedure. It would still be one open surgery, but they would not need a second stage procedure. For the acute dissections, although it's a big operation, you know that the acute dissections are the biggest emergencies that a cardiac surgeon can face. So with this graft, if we treat the arch and put this stent in the descending aorta, then these patients, we have shown over the last 20 years that do not come back, at least for the arch and the descending aorta. If they do come back for the lower part of the descending, they can still be treated with a TEVA. So that means for the patients, either they don't come back, or if they come back, they need it, only a TEVA. Because we know that in acute dissections, if we don't touch the total arch or with the frozen elephant trunk, up to 30% of these patients come back for a redo arch.
I see. So it seems like the main advantage then is one open surgery treats the problem with a risk, a small risk, but a risk of needing an endovascular procedure down the road, but the open surgery is more definitive.
Yeah, correct. Because they need one open surgery anyway for the first stage. So that does away with the second one. Yeah,
I see. Okay. Now, many of our listeners will be cardiologists as well as other specialists who are not practicing cardiac surgery. So one of the questions would be, is there anything special or any considerations during follow-up of a patient who's had a frozen elephant trunk procedure, findings on physical exam, specific imaging studies that are useful? What should the cardiologist know about treating a patient following the procedure, both early afterwards and longer term?
So for the follow-up, what I would advise would be to get a CT scan before discharge. So we have a baseline CT scan. And then if, depending on whether it's an aneurysm, maybe one after 6 months and yearly afterwards. And in acute dissection, one maybe 3 to 6 months and then yearly afterwards. And here, because you have done so great a job with artificial intelligence, I think a role could be there. Because otherwise, a radiologist would have to spend half an hour going through the CT scans. If you could develop some sort of, protocol for that also, that would really help, especially the radiologists in smaller hospitals to do the follow-ups. And that would save the patients, having to come back to Mayo Clinic or bigger centers. And also, sometimes the computer would not miss what sometimes the doctors may miss.
No, that's a phenomenal suggestion. Yeah. What are the complications that the cardiologist following a patient should look for, and how common are they?
The complications would be not the graft itself, that only because the aorta is diseased, then the cardiologist or any follow-up physicians have to look for is whether the aorta is dilating in follow-up. So if it becomes larger and larger and more than, let's say, 6 centimeters, then we may have to do a re-intervention again. So that's the most important thing.
Got it. Okay. Now, you are a co-inventor of this. How many of these procedures have you done?
I myself have done, I haven't counted, but around 300 plus of these.
Yeah.
This is one of the, at least in the Western world, the largest series, I would say. But worldwide, more than 25,000 have been done with this graft alone. So this is a big number.
Oh, that is remarkable. Well, Dr. Shrestha, thank you so much for joining us today. It is remarkable how these surgical improvements are improving outcomes, and your leadership has been so important for the Aorta Center for helping us have frequent reviews of diagnosing, detecting, and treating aortic pathology. So thank you for your expertise.
Thank you, Paul. Thanks again. Yeah.